The yearning for Zion had been an element in Judaism since the diaspora began, but religious teaching maintained that only Mashiach, the Messiah, could lead the people back to their homeland. It was only in the revolutionary and nationalistic 19th century in Europe that it crystallized into a political movement for the return of the Jews to the land of Israel. Zionism emerged relatively late because European Jews were concerned with becoming useful citizens of the states in which they lived. There was no longer a Jewish people, but a Jewish religion. It was the rise of modern nationalism, race theory, and the development of modern racial anti-Semitism that led to the creation of Zionism. It also attracted adherents amongst Jews living under Tsarist rule who were persecuted and still denied any rights. The term Zionism was created in 1891 by Nathan Birnbaum, but the ideas predate it. There were various forerunners, often outsiders acutely aware of political currents. One such man, Moses Hess, wrote his pamphlet Rome and Jerusalem in 1862. Rome was modern Rome, Jerusalem, modern Jerusalem. It included the following phrase: "The Germans hate the Jews, not for their peculiar religion, but for their peculiar noses." He was publicly mocked in the leading German Jewish newspapers. "We are first and foremost Germans, Frenchmen, and Englishmen." Meanwhile, in the Russian Empire, as a response to the pogroms of 1881 to 1882, Leon Pinsker wrote his pamphlet Auto-Emancipation. He wrote it in German as a warning cry to the Jews of the West. He stated, "The Western world suffers from Judaphobia. It is a psychic aberration, a 2,000-year-old disease, and is incurable." He was mocked, particularly by the sophisticated Jews of Vienna. Yet from 1881 onwards, inspired by these ideas, there was a small movement of Jews to return to the land of Israel, then under Turkish rule. It took an extraordinary charismatic Hungarian-born journalist, Theodor Herzl, who had the will and vision to create a political movement. Herzl, 1860 to 1904, attended the University of Vienna, where he was an assimilationist. Gradually, the anti-Semitism he perceived there and in France, where he was a correspondent for a Viennese newspaper, changed his mind. The Dreyfus affair had an impact on him. Dreyfus, the only Jew on the French general staff, was accused of selling secrets to the Germans. He was found guilty in camera. What disgusted many observers was that when Dreyfus was publicly dishonored, before being sent to Devil's Island, the mob, whipped up by anti-Semitic newspapers, were screaming not death to Dreyfus, but death to the Jews. A man of action, Herzl realized the need to create an international political movement. The majority of influential Jews he approached, including Baron Morris de Hirsch, scorned his ideas. They were frightened of the perception that Jews had dual loyalties, both to their respective countries and to Jews worldwide. But he had some converts, two important writers, Max Nordau and Israel Zangwill. The latter facilitated an article in the London-based Jewish Chronicle. And in February 1896, his pamphlet, The Jewish State, was published. He attracted enough of a following for the next step, the convening of the first Zionist Congress. It was to be held in Munich, but leading Jewish citizens of the town protested, so it was moved to Basel in Switzerland. The Congress of August 1897 attracted a lot of attention, with journalists attending from all over the world. Most of the delegates were from Eastern Europe, rooted in the Jewish tradition and focused on a return to the ancient homeland. After the three-day conference, Herzl wrote in his diary, "Today I created the Jewish state. Maybe in 5 years, certainly in 50, it will be a reality." Ironically, 50 years later, in November 1947, the United Nations partitioned Palestine into a Jewish state and an Arab state. Herzl died in 1904. He had tirelessly devoted his last years to the cause, attempting to achieve high levels of support from the governments of Europe. His greatest success was with the British, who in 1903 offered him a homeland in Africa. All this occurred after a devastating pogrom in Kishinev. Herzl was prepared to accept it as a stepping stone, but it was the Eastern European delegates who ensured that only the land of Israel could fulfill Jewish destiny. Herzl was only 44 years old when he died and was buried in Vienna, and over 3,000 people attended his funeral. In 1949, his body was reinterred on a mount named for him, Mount Herzl. At the end of the conference, Israel Zangwill, who was a famous writer, stated, "In Babylon, we lay down by the river and wept. In Baal, we lay down by the river and resolved to weep no more."
To stay up to date with JTV content, click subscribe here if you're on YouTube and hit the alarm bell. And if you're on Facebook, hit the like button and under following, click see first. If you enjoy watching JTV content and want to help us continue to grow, please consider making a donation to us by clicking here.